a child of the King, a child of the King, with Jesus my Savior, I'm a child of the King. You know what, dear folks? I think I'll leave it there. Is that okay with y'all? I just realized that's as much as I'm going to be able to sing. There's a glass, there's a thing of water in here, but is that mine or Lloyd's? Is anybody going to sit over here at all? Nancy? Proverbs chapter 20, two verses. Proverbs chapter 20. Is Ford our new sound technician back there? Is he? He's nodding his head yes. As good as these kids are at electronics, they probably would be okay. Do good at it. Don't you think it's amazing, even as little as like Jay is, they know where the on button is. They know where to go turn things on. I'm just going to use the two verses. It's the third part of, and I do have a few folks that have been following in on a Wednesday night and on the Sunday evenings. So, Proverbs 20, verse 10. Divers weights and divers measures, both of them are alike abomination to the Lord. And then down to verse number 23. Hey, thank you, Mo. Verse 23, divers, or we might say diverse, or varied, or many, divers weights are an abomination unto the Lord, and a false balance is not good. This idea of the weights, or the balance, as realized is used here, is dishonesty, specifically dishonesty in weighted scales of the economy. A dishonest transaction, cheating someone of their product, on the scales. God detests, it's an abomination to him that you'd run your economy weighted or unfair, a false balance, a dishonest balance. But I'm using that in the idea that a false balance is not good. I wanted to just use that as a springboard, as an illustration of the balance between legalism and liberty, or should I say the balance between law and standards and rules and regulations and freedom. When I come down to the subject of legalism, it would be tipping the scales with man-made rules and regulations. Beyond grace, overburdening a relationship with God or standards of which God himself had not detailed. One way to have an out of balance, or two ways in particular mentioned, to be out of balance with legalism or the law or standards, because there is a stricter definition of legalism that's being too broad, would be hypocrisy. Hypocrisy, not a real relationship with the Lord. Just an outward show. We use Matthew 6 with apparel, with prayers, with the idea of pretentious acting, of being something you're truly not. Hypocrisy. Then there would be the additional doctrine, and that would be more in line with what true legalism is. Book of Galatians. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. But to Paul's amazement, I'm amazed you've added to the gospel already things that even God himself didn't add. Works of the law, but if someone believes that those works of the law would gain them salvation, they're sorely mistaken. But don't go out of balance on this. If you love me, keep my commandments. There is the idea of obeying and having some standards in which God is well pleased. And he'll say, well done. I tried to just abbreviate it by this way of introduction. To have religion without true relationship, that'd be Phariseeism. That would be legalism. Hypocrisy and additional doctrine, as that being what makes one right with God. And I know God looks upon the heart. Man looks on the outward apparel. But it doesn't mean that God discounts the outward apparel. Even in Timothy, he'd write to be adorned with modest apparel. And we'd see it in the scriptures. Let your light so shine that men may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. And just by way of a simple illustration, as we begin in this portion of the Bible study, Tammy and I were eating at a restaurant in Bluefield Friday. We're sitting there. A young couple came in, sat in the booth over across the aisle from us over there. They dressed pretty decent, pretty sharp. Had a little girl with her, maybe 2 years old, three. They sat down, and I looked at Tammy and said, "That's a Christian couple." And the waiter came out, brought their stuff. They held hands and prayed. But I'd already guessed. I said, they look like a Christian couple. Their mannerisms, their neatness, and then they prayed before they ate. So it does make a testimony to people to have some certain standards. Not that, and I'm sure God would be well pleasing with that because it brings glory to God. You can say that. Isn't it nice that there's still young families who are willing to pray? That brings glory to God in that kind of testimony. So I continue on. That's enough. Psalms 119, verse 45. You recognize Psalms 119 as the longest psalm of the Psalms, but also the one that is specifically about God's Word. And how he identifies God's word is seven distinct ways in that passage. Psalms 119. I could begin at the law of the Lord. It's something that the word of God is considered the law of the Lord. We see in verse 2, his testimonies. We see, like say, in the end of verse 4, thy precepts. Verse number 5, we see thy statutes. It has the idea of doing a foundation or a pillar or a column. That's what holds things up. We see in verse 6, commandments. Look at the end of verse 7, judgments. All these have to do with God's word. We wouldn't know it translated into English, but Psalms 119 is a poem written in the Hebrew that each one of the verses starts with. How you write it? It's not an acronym, but it's written. Each verse starts with a letter of the Hebrew alphabet. We lose that poetry in English, but it has idea with testimonies and statutes, the law of the Lord, his precepts. It's the precepts that I find the Bible dictionary says a general rule intended to regulate behavior or thought. Now, isn't that something? It's the Word of God that gives us his general rules intended to regulate behavior and thought. It's a tenet. It's a principle. So you have to at least acknowledge God's Word. The very nature of God's Word is to give us some guidelines, to give us some tenets, to give us some principles, to give us some rules. Let's not be afraid of them. We realize that it's a good testimony of the Lord to have some standards. When I come to this portion of the passage, you see, look at verse 45 now, where it uses the word precept along with something else. Psalms 119, verse 45. I jumped ahead of it too soon. There it is. I will walk at liberty, for I seek thy precepts. I will walk at liberty while I seek your rules, while I seek your principles, while I seek your tenets, while I seek your regulations. But I'll walk at liberty. There must be good, righteous, fair balance between the law and liberty. See if we can explain some. There are differences, and they're clearly stated that they are distinct states of being. Romans chapter 8, verse 20. We'll recognize that a great passage that has to deal with creation and devolution, falling away from God. They worshiped the creature more than the creator. Wherefore, God gave them up. But some preceding verses, we see two distinct states. Romans 8, verse number 20. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. The creature, the creation, what is of God's making, is subject to uselessness or vanity, but not without hope. There was a cause for it, and there is a remedy for it. Not a complete doctrinal study of this passage, but to show you two states. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption unto the glorious liberty of the children of God. There is a natural state of the earth right now. You know what it is? Corruption. You know what it is? Bondage to sin. Wherefore is one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men. 1 Corinthians we see we're now subject to this in this mortal body, to corruption, to decay, to falling apart. You say, but I'm getting older and getting better. Wait a little longer. Just keep waiting. There's a certain destiny. Benjamin Franklin, you're going to pay your taxes, and there's death. Right? Not going to escape those two things. There is a certain decay that is going to set in. The earth creation is subject to that, but not without hope. There's a remedy for that, and the remedy of that is the glorious liberty of the children of God. We have the promise of God someday to be rescued from this corruptible that must put on incorruption. There's two distinct states, born of Adam, sin, death, corruption. Born again by the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, by the blood of Christ, there's a hope, and there is a day of incorruptible to come. Two distinct states. The glorious liberty of the children of God. What hope and what liberty do I have of being God's child? I know what's coming. I know what he's promised. I have exceedingly great and precious promises. Though I'm in the state of a world of corruption, I have something different. I have a freedom in Christ Jesus. I'm not under the bondage, and not have the ball and chain still about me of failure and vanity and uselessness and corruption. 2 Corinthians, John chapter 8. I have a very simple ending in the next 15 minutes, but I got to work my way to it. John chapter 8. Let's not forget something, okay? John 8. And let me show you some people who did. John 8, verse 32. We said this on Wednesday night. 8 is great. It's the chapter 8, it comes to the grand conclusion of who Jesus is. Who makest thou thyself? And he ends with a great declaration, I am. John 8, well, there's these the ones that dispute with Jesus because they think by their laws, they think by their regulations, they think by their birth, physical birth, they got it all. John 8, I'm there, verse 32 through 34. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Isn't that a classic statement by the Lord? You'll know the truth will make you free. They answered him, this is that Pharisee crowd he was addressing down in verse 25, and they say unto him, etc. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and we were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Now look who he's addressing. He's addressing the Pharisees. Who is he addressing? Those who believe their religious works, their philanthropies, their broad garments and stripes and bells and whistles and their long prayers. And by their much, Jesus said, except you do the deeds of the Pharisees or exceed them, you'll not see the kingdom of God. They had exceeding great works. And Jesus said, but if you knew the truth, you'd be free. And they said, we've never been in bondage to anybody. I've said this on that Wednesday night. What are they forgetting? They've been in bondage numerous times. Are they forgetting Egypt when their forefathers cried out in great travail saying, deliver us, from the bondage of Egypt? Did they not forget that just maybe like 500 years before this? It seemed like a long time, but not really. Think of the history of America from 1492. So we know some history. Are they forgetting that their fathers cried out in Babylon for 70 years? That their city Jerusalem was burned to the ground? That their temple was ransacked? We've not been in bondage any man. Well, you're forgetting your heritage. Similar to our country is today. And by the way, could Jesus not say, give me one of your coins again? Whose image is on that coin? Oh, even your money has Caesar's picture on it. And you're paying your taxes not to your local government, you're paying your taxes to Rome. What are they forgetting? We're not being bondage to any man. You're forgetting the subjugation you're under even right now. But what it mostly is, not just the physical aspect, the spiritual aspect. If they knew the truth would set them free from all that religious works, trying to be right with God or appear right with God. See how this is continued with Apostle Paul, 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 15. You know what those Pharisees didn't realize? All their religious works that they're dragging around are a ball and chain, and they're still in corruption. They're still not right with God. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 15. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart. Just briefly, even in this text of passage, those that are with the work salvation and exceeding the laws and rules and regulations, they're just like Moses, and they still can't see. It's still covered. Now watch verse 16. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. When you come to the truth, when you come to Jesus, watch verse 17. Now the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So I have this glorious liberty of freedom from rules and regulations to try to save me. Or to even try to appear to other people with great hypocrisy that some righteousness. What a weight. But in Christ Jesus, with his Holy Spirit, we have a freedom. But a freedom. But you say, but Brother Rick, that's just telling us what we have in Christ. You saying, what about a false balance? My liberty is never to be at the expense or abuse of other people. My liberty is not to be at the expense or the abuse of other people. So that's putting very simple. In Romans chapter 6, verse 1, here's a question asked by the Apostle Paul, and you say, boy, that is a nonsense of a question. But look how they looked at it. When we say a nonsense of a question, it's the super hypothetical question of the Sadducees who didn't believe in the resurrection, asking Jesus and saying, if someone get married seven times according to law, whose wife will she be? They didn't really want an answer. They just saw out this super hypothetical situation to befuddle and get befuddle Christ about the scriptures and the law, the Sadducees, those liberal. Now watch this. What? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? What kind of question is that? Think that through. Well, in the preceding chapter, where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I was singing that song earlier this week. Heaven, where sin abounded, grace abounded more. My raptured soul repeats it o'er and o'er. I love the song. Where sin abounded, grace abounded more. Don't we like that? Don't we love that? I do. Then who would possibly think this next? I've got to say it. Who would possibly think this next? You're in Walmart. The lights go out. All the workers are told to go to the stations at the aisles. Why? So people don't start shoplifting. Who possibly thinks, lights are out, time to shoplift? Who possibly thinks God's grace abounds more than sin? Oh, great, then we'll sin more so we can have more grace. Who thinks like that? Somebody did. But since there's grace for sin, let's have more sin so we have more grace. What's his answer to that? God forbid. Know ye not that for your sins is why Christ died. He died to save you from that. And his grace is exceeding enough to forgive even the chiefest of sinners. You shouldn't think, well, we'll sin more. It's not a liberty to just do what you want. Get it? God forbid. Why would you even think that way? He died. He became a man. He died to save you from that. Glory to God for his grace. But don't think you ought to continue in it. Liberty is not a license to sin. It's a freedom within his precepts, his parameters to live right. And his parameters and his precepts are good. The commandments of the Lord are righteous altogether and good. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. Should have told you to hold a finger there. We're coming back. 1 Corinthians 8, verse 9. Can I just use one verse because we'll be out of time? But take heed lest by any means this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to them that are weak. So you have this glorious freedom from sin and forgiveness of sin. It's not a license to sin. It is not a license to abuse or wound other people. I jumped ahead of myself a couple Sunday or so ago to give you a couple illustrations. My liberty is, and what comes to this, is not to be a stumbling block or a tripping stone for other people. The idea of meats, that was a big issue in those days. Meats offered to sacrifices. A weak brother thinks, oh, I shouldn't do that because that's offered to a false god. We that are strong in faith know that there's no such thing as another god. That's just a worthless piece of plastic or a worthless carving piece of wood or worthless carving out of a piece of stone. It's a god that can't see. It's a god that can't hear. That's what they call a god, but we know it's not one. So that's a free piece of meat. But if the weaker brother doesn't know that, I'm not to use my liberty to eat to cause him to stumble. A stumbling stone. I can put it in more common terms. They had the days. They had the days. They had the diets. Free to eat. Yay. Free to worship on Sunday and not on Saturday. Free to worship on Wednesday and not on Thursday. Freedom of what day to worship. But others say, no, you can't worship on that day because that day is dedicated to Thor. Or that day dedicated to the sun god. Don't use your liberty to cause a weaker brother or others to stumble. If I can put it this way, I have the freedom in the United States of America, the Second Amendment, to have a high-powered rifle, high-powered hunting rifle. I have the freedom and a right to carry a concealed weapon in America. I have that freedom. But with that freedom comes great responsibility. Guess what also is within the parameters or precepts of that freedom? I cannot shoot my high-powered hunting rifle within 600 feet of a dwelling. Amen? Your bullet that can go a mile and a half can go through someone else's door or window or wall. I don't have my freedom of my concealed weapon to go down the city streets of Princeton at 2 in the morning and go, Happy New Year! Boom, 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 boom! Why? What goes up? Go ahead and say it. Must come down. Somewhere, lead's going to fall. Had some teenage boys that went to a soccer game at the Tampa Stadium years ago from our youth department. Bobby Brennan and Danny Sampson and Richie Miller, and I'm trying to think of getting them all together. Seen some dudes. They went to the soccer game that was being held as a special thing on New Year's night, and then it was going to end with fireworks display, you know, welcome New Year. So this professional soccer game, fireworks are going on, boom, 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 everyone's cheering, having a good time. And Bobby said, hey, he looked at Danny and said, why'd you punch me? And Danny said, I didn't punch you. And he said, yeah, right, you hit my, and he put his hand leg and blood was coming out of his leg. Someone in the stadium was shooting a .38 pistol. And he took a slug in the leg and thought of his friend beside him and punched him. Oh, you got the right to carry an arm. Not in a crowded stadium, and you can't shoot it in the air when the fireworks are going off, right? Liberty, freedom, responsibility. I find it something amazing. When we first got our Volkswagen in 1966, and then Tammy had a little, and I had a, she had a 72, I had a 66. Then we, together, when we got married, we bought a Volkswagen station wagon while we was in college, a little light blue Volkswagen station wagon. It had 60 horsepower. You know, it had trickle heat out of the back seat in wintertime. It was a miserable little car, but got us through. 60 horsepower. Shoot, our lawnmowers have that now, some of them. But you know what? You can buy a production engine Dodge Challenger or something for 400 horsepower. I mean, when that thing says 180, really, that. So you're allowed to have this car and go down and buy a production car now with over 400 horsepower. And some of them even turbocharged. That does not give you the freedom to drive over 70 miles an hour in a school zone. But my car do 180. Yeah, but in the school zone, you got to do what? 15. But look at all this horsepower. Whoa, look what I can do with it. I can romp on it. I can pull on the emergency brake and break loose the back tires on a front wheel car. And man, I can spin that baby around. Yeah, you can. But not in our parking lot. Really, not in someone's yard. Not on someone's not on someone's soccer field. Why? You have freedom to buy a really nice, high-powered car. You have a responsibility to with that freedom within the parameters of the law and safety for who? Other people. All that to say this, God's given us a false balance is abomination to the Lord. He detests someone who would dishonestly with weights and measures and scales take advantage of someone else. Catch this now. In our Christian life, there's the standards that God has that are good for our testimony. Don't take that out of balance. Don't tip scales too far. And then there's the liberty that God gives us to live and enjoy the faith that we have. But let's make sure we keep it within the perimeters too, of glory to God and helps to other people. I believe that's good to say. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13 in closing. Galatians 5, verse 13. Chapter 2 told us that we know that we're not saved by the works of the law. Chapter 5, verse 13 has this wonderful verse. Chapter 5, verse 1. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. I know that deals primarily with the doctrinal stance on salvation, but it's a great verse also. Stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. Let's close with a word of prayer. Thank you for coming, staying, giving some folks that joined in with us. Hope that you enjoyed being with us this afternoon. Let's pray together. Holy Father, bless, I pray. What a wonderful day to be in the Lord's house. Sunday school morning this afternoon. What a privilege three times already to hear the eternal word of God. I am so grateful for it. Bless our week before us. May it be a good week at school, at work, whatever we do. May we bring honor and glory to your name, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord bless you.